Carmella, we all know that small businesses have been greatly affected by COVID-19. Mm-hmm. And they're going to be and are already adapting to the pandemic. Could you please tell us about the impact on COVID from a small business perspective, both the companies you serve, but also you have your own experience that you can share with us?
Yes, thank you for having me. From what we've seen when COVID hit, from being a business owner as well as counseling businesses, we found oftentimes with minority, specifically Black-owned businesses, that the customer base was not diversified enough to be supported outside of their community. So with there being a lot of individuals who were laid off, incomes not coming in, those businesses were actually feeling that. Essential workers who were underpaid, that, you know, they weren't getting what they were used to getting as far as clientele. And so with that, what we wanted to do, because since COVID hit, all of the large events were also canceled, which put a lot of small businesses under great stress, because if, for instance, my business, 60% of the income was reliant upon actual in-person, face-to-face expos and conferences where, you know, people would vend at, especially consumer packaged goods companies. So at the incubator, we actually started to create opportunities to train those individuals to learn how to pivot from being the going from brick and mortar to streamlining their actual how they were getting access to their clientele and going online. So a lot of the times we saw that there wasn't a website or they didn't have digital media presence. So we helped them to do that. Also, what we were able to do was provide cross-marketing opportunities to businesses who might not have had a predominantly white customer base outside of the Black and brown communities. So by doing that, more of the community became aware of them and as a result could support them by purchasing. Incomes got shut down, so now we were trying to help them apply for the EIDL loan and the PPP and for some unemployment. So it became extremely hard. It became very serious. And as the counselors at YBI, we got in the trenches with people. You know, we were literally trying to do all that we could, weekends, nights, to make sure that they were getting that handheld experience, because a lot of times they were not familiar with how to even do the process. So they had several questions. It wasn't just send them a link and here you go.
Presently, we do see the demand for space slowly but surely starting to go back up. At the beginning of the crisis, we realized that it was a very tough time to actually go looking for businesses to locate, to expand, or make large-scale investments in our community. So we realized that it really was necessary to kind of pivot where we were focused in terms of our work plan as an organization. We realized we still possessed organizations that related to small businesses and could also be deployed at this point in time to assist. Those skills being outreach and engagement, also being able to manage data. And then we were also a part of the local COVID task force, which took many of the partners on the call today and others regionally to weekly meetings via Zoom, where we discussed the priorities and the gaps in service, where we kind of found our place to deploy our skill set. Doing that, we worked with both the cities of Youngstown and Warren locally in the Mahoning Valley to do this outreach service to make businesses, small businesses, aware of the federal resources available through the CARES Act and any resources that eventually became available through the city's block grant allocation. The results of our efforts personally, our team has quadrupled in size. We've made thousands of calls and reached out to over 1,800 businesses in the Mahoning Valley. 720 responses, more than 720. And we've certainly seen the impact of these programs making a positive impact on the region. We've seen it from the very early onset of the pandemic, being in the very low percentages, 1% and 2%. ticking up. I think we're near 15% of the businesses that we've had contact with have actually received resources, with even more still interested, still applying and still going for additional resources as the reopening process starts.
You've already spoken about minority and women-owned businesses and some of the innovations. Can you talk a little bit more about how you see that playing out in terms of, are we going to be able to actually support those businesses more? Are they going to need a different kind of support than we've had in the past to advance? I'd be really interested in hearing your views on that.
I think I would like to definitely see intentional relationships being formed with women and minority-owned businesses from a banking perspective more so. What I saw on the ground were a lot of the companies who did not have a personal banker did not get any type of response in regards to their PPP application, one. Two, a lot of the times when, even if they did, what I did see is that they were not being accepted, or they weren't eligible, because a lot of small businesses, minority and women-owned businesses, have 1099s and not actual payroll, right? So they're not doing a payroll taxation. It's usually just themselves. So they do it as an owner's withdrawal. So that actually they weren't eligible for a PPP. Now they might've been eligible for the EIDL loan. But again, only $10,000 of that was actually being able to be forgivable. So there's a lot of businesses, small businesses, that are missing out on the forgivable PPP that I think could, and that's a lot of the times why they're not applying for it, because they can't apply for it because they're 1090, they have 1099s, they don't have employees. So I would like to see that expanded to where it actually is inclusive of businesses who have contractors and not just employees.
So Nick, can I turn to you now? You had already said that you're starting to look forward. Can you talk a little bit about what issues you think are coming on the horizon for the businesses that you deal with, and
Absolutely.
How you can address them?
We see this as an opportunity for cities locally and municipalities to be very creative and data driven in terms of the approach that they take to address problems that may be faced at the neighborhood or sector level by businesses. And we've already started some of those efforts with Mayor Brown in Youngstown. And it's really a good opportunity for cities to reestablish clear paths of communication with businesses, with residents, to establish those public-private partnerships to make sure it goes both ways. Also, a second consideration in the process is the equity. As we go back to analyze our program and the impact we've had, we're looking at it at the neighborhood level and seeing if there were any disparities in terms of responses from one area versus another. And then we also want our future projects, as we begin to come back to some normal programming, benefiting the neighborhoods that they're located in. We want the residents, women and minority within the city, to be able to benefit from these programs and access them, and making sure that our planning takes place along main transit corridors, which are big considerations before a project starts off.
For over a century, Farmers National Bank has stood strong. Through booms and busts, peaks and valleys, we've learned to know the seasons and how to grow in each of them. During challenging times, everyone is reminded of the value of solid relationships in both life and business. Farmers, stand strong.